night in the forest complained of fear, and sings into the glory of the Lord. He is a son and bringer of faith, who carries the light, the Lord in his grace, the Lord in his sight, to light up the way,
the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with all of you. Amen. We come together to praise the author of life and the source of our blessings. We come to be renewed by the power of heaven, which is the love of God outpoured, the grace that transforms us into the people that God has made us to be. So let us prepare now to celebrate the sacred mysteries, asking the Lord to renew our hearts and souls by pardoning our sins and pouring upon us the life-giving, renewing grace of heaven. Forgive us our sins and bring us to everlasting life.
Glory to God, glory to God, glory to God in the highest, and on earth, peace on earth, peace to people of good will. We praise you. We bless you, we adore you, we glorify you, we give thanks for your great glory, Lord, our heavenly King, O God of mighty worship, Lord Jesus Christ, only begotten Son. Son of the Father,
God of might, giver of every good gift, put into our hearts the love of your name, so that deepening our sense of reverence, you may nurture in us what is good, and by your watchful care, keep safe what you have nurtured. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
Reading from the book of Deuteronomy. Moses said to the people, "Now, Israel, hear the statutes and decrees which I am teaching you to observe, that you may live and may enter in and take possession of the land which the Lord, the God of your fathers, is giving you. In your observance of the commandments of the Lord your God, which I enjoin upon you, you shall not add to what I command you, nor subtract from it. Observe them carefully, for thus will you give evidence of your wisdom and intelligence to the nations, who will hear of all these statutes and say, 'This great nation is truly a wise and intelligent people.' For what great nation is there that has God so close to it as the Lord our God is to us whenever we call upon him? Or what great nation has statutes and decrees that are as just as this whole law which I am setting before you today?" The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
The one who does try.
from the letter of St. James. Dearest brothers and sisters, all good giving and every perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of lights, with whom there is no alteration or shadow caused by change. He willed to give us birth by the word of truth, that we may be a kind of first fruit to his creatures. Humbly welcome the word that has been planted in you and is able to save your souls. Be doers of the word and not hearers only, deluding yourselves. Religion that is pure and undefiled before God and the Father is this: to care for orphans and widows in their affliction, and to keep oneself unstained by the world. The word of the Lord.
When the Pharisees, with some scribes who had come from Jerusalem, gathered around Jesus, they observed that some of his disciples ate their meals with unclean, that is, unwashed hands. For the Pharisees, and in fact all Jews, do not eat without carefully washing their hands and keeping the tradition of the elders. And on coming from the marketplace, they do not eat without purifying themselves. And there are many other things that they have traditionally observed, the purification of cups and jugs and kettles and beds. So the Pharisees and scribes questioned him, "Why do your disciples not follow the tradition of the elders, but instead eat a meal with unclean hands?" He responded, "Well did Isaiah prophesy about you hypocrites, as it is written, 'This people honors me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. In vain do they worship me, teaching as doctrines human precepts. You disregard God's commandment, but cling to human traditions.'" He summoned the crowd again and said to them, "Hear me, all of you, and understand, nothing that enters from outside can defile that person, but that things that come from within are what defile. From within people, from their hearts, come evil thoughts, unchastity, theft, murder, adultery, greed, malice, deceit, licentiousness, envy, blasphemy, arrogance, folly, and all these evils come from within, and they defile." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Carlo Maria Martini was an Italian who became a member of the Society of Jesus, the religious order of the Jesuits. He also was a distinguished biblical scholar And eventually, he became the Archbishop of Milan between 1980 and 2004. And he was actually, shortly after that, 1983, named to the College of Cardinals. I like to think that an Italian by the name of Martini, especially an archbishop, must be pretty good, huh? And he was an extraordinary man, gifted scholar and pastor. But during his many years in service as Archbishop of Milan, he encountered a number of pastoral situations that were brought to his attention. One particular situation was reported to him from a parish in which a young couple had gone to the pastor in anticipation of their forthcoming marriage and asked if they could organize a nice reception after the marriage in the parish courtyard. And so all of that was approved. Well, then the day of the marriage came, and it was pouring rain. And so the couple went to the pastor and said, "It's pouring rain now. Could we please move our reception into the church?" Well, the pastor wasn't very comfortable with all of that, but the couple said, "Look, we will keep it very simple. We will drink a little wine. We will sing a little song, eat a little food, and then that will be it." And the pastor somewhat reluctantly said, "Okay." Well, then the marriage happened and the reception happened. And of course, being good Italians, they drank a little wine and they sang a little song. And then they drank a little more wine and had a little more song and music. And within about a half hour, there was a pretty big party going on in the church. And the pastor was beside himself. He was fuming and he was pacing up and down. And the more he paced, the more disturbed he became by the whole thing. And so the young assistant came up to him and said, "Father, you seem to be very upset." And he said, "Well, look at what's going on in the church. All of that noise, all of that commotion, all of that disrespect." And the young assistant said, "Well, yes, Father, but they're not really being that bad." And the priest just became furious. And so the young assistant said, "Well, now, Father, don't forget, let's not forget that the Lord Jesus himself was at a wedding and a wedding banquet at Cana." And the old pastor said, "Look, young man, I don't need anyone telling me that the Lord Jesus was at a wedding banquet at Cana. I know he was at the wedding of Cana. But there at Cana, they didn't have the Blessed Sacrament." Did you catch it? Now, certainly, out of respect for the sacred place and the presence of the reserved Eucharist, we have decorum, we have respect. But the pastor, in his desire to observe decorum and the rules, got to a place, at least in that situation, if not in his ministry, where he got disconnected from the Blessed Sacrament, which is the body of Christ, and the Lord Jesus, who is the Blessed Sacrament and the body of Christ. And it can be very easy for us to get disconnected from some of those realities. Now, this is what happened to the Israelite people by the time of Jesus. You know, the Israelite people, for generation upon generation, prided themselves not only on just being the chosen people of God, but being a people whose lives were governed by the law of God, the commandments of God, and that they lived in a way no other people, no other society have been chosen or privileged to live. In fact, it might be said
that the Israelites were the first people to have a constitution of sorts to live by. And their constitution was the Ten Commandments, which ordered our relationship with God and our relationship with others in God's name, to clearly live the values and principles of God in their lives and in the world. But of course, they found it challenging to live those commandments at times because of the events of ordinary life and also some of the more traumatic events that happened to their society. After King David had not only unified the Israelite people and built a beautiful temple in Jerusalem to house the Holy of Holies, the Ark of the Covenant, the Law of God, the Ten Commandments of Moses, within 30 years, about 970 BC, with the death of his son, the kingdom had become divided into a northern and southern half. And that division was so bad that the northern half even created its own temple to rival the temple in Jerusalem that David had built. And then, in time, the relationship deteriorated between these people, and in time, the northern kingdom fell to the Assyrians in the year 722 BC. And the northern Israelites were taken away to be captive into a foreign land, giving rise to what we call the Lost Ten Tribes of Israel. They intermarried and intermixed their religion and their way of life with the other people that they now lived with. And in time, the southern kingdom based in Jerusalem also fell to the Babylonians in 587 BC. And many of those people were taken off into captivity. Now, during this whole time of the fracturing of the kingdom, people that were dispersed and people that were alienated from their home in Jerusalem placed a great emphasis on trying to be the best Israelites that they could be, even as some members of their family were marrying into the non-Israelite societies and even adopting other gods than the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And so they began to turn to learned men who became known as scribes to try to explain how to live the law of God in a way that perhaps when the law was written and given to Moses, the circumstances of life hadn't prepared for. Well, these scribes, over time, have a number of opinions on how to follow the rules. And so by the time we get to several generations before Jesus, the original Ten Commandments also included 603 additional opinions of scribes. So there were 613 commandments that were there. And there was a great rigor on how to live the law of God. Into this mix entered the Pharisees. Now, the Pharisees wanted people to understand the law, but they also wanted to make it strict so that everyone was righteous, in right relationship with God and right relationship with their neighbor and upright. And so the Pharisees made it very exacting to try to follow the laws. So this is the scene now that we encountered with Jesus today, when he is presented with yet another attempt to trip him up and to somehow make it look like he does not respect or follow the law of God, which is ironic. We know that they didn't at the time. And so they present a variety of things to him. His apostles, his followers, they're not going through the set number of ritual washings throughout the day. Before you take a piece of food, you have to wash yet again. Even the kettles, the cooking implements that you use to cook, have to be ritually washed a certain way before and after you use them. Absolutely everything had to be handled according to the exacting standards of the law. And what Jesus says to all of this is, quoting the great prophet Isaiah, "The people follow me with their voice, but not their hearts." They're following the law blindly at this point. They're probably trying to be good Israelites, but they're following the law blindly and not living the law
with their hearts so that they can please God and follow God's ways. And I think there's the lesson for us now as disciples of Jesus, as successors of those first disciples and apostles. There's our lesson. Because, you see, we have a constitution of sorts that Jesus gave us. When he was asked, which is the greatest of the laws? Of course, they weren't just talking about the 10, they were talking about the 613. And he said, you shall love the Lord your God with your whole heart, soul, and mind. And you shall love your neighbor as yourself. Which was, of course, a brilliant synthesizing of the Ten Commandments. Matthew 22, verses 37 to 40. But he also gave a few other principles that were very close and near to the hearts of his followers. And he told them, judge not others, lest you be judged. Matthew 7, verse 1, from the Sermon on the Mount. And then a few verses later in the record, when he said, do unto others as you would have them do to you. The golden rule from verse 12 toward the end of the Sermon on the Mount. Those basic principles of Jesus are the constitution that we live by as Christians. We have many beautiful traditions, customs, practices, many different things that we do to show respect to the Lord and to engage in our prayer, our worship, our adoration, our service of the mission. And those are wonderful things, provided that we're doing it from our hearts and not just going through the motions. There are times to go through the motions when we are struggling and having a difficult time and we need something to hold on to. But that's a time of crisis. That's not a way of life. What Jesus is interested in is how we are loving and serving the Lord, and loving and serving others in his name, and whether we're doing it with love. And if we aren't, then we take a lesson from this encounter, and we ask the Lord to fill us once again with his love and grace, so that we may do all the things that we do in his name, for all of the right reasons. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us then, for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. The Lord is good, merciful, and forgiving, full of mercy to all who call upon him. And so we open our hearts and raise our voices, pray for the needs of the church and the world.
For the church, that she grows in unity and remember Christ's call, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the political leaders that are at the service of their own people, working for an integral development and for the common good, especially caring for the poor and those who have lost their jobs. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our new parish, St. Thomas More and Holy Rosary, that over the coming years we may truly become one family of faith, focused on Christ and proclaiming His gospel. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who are sick and the homebound, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who have died, especially Nikki House, that God grace them with His goodness, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all of us who are gathered here, and the prayers we hold in the silence of our hearts, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Most generous Lord, instill in all of those entrusted with preaching the gospel and living it in our lives your wisdom and justice, so that all generations may come to know the living Word who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Let all who believe in me come to me, number 467, 467.
Thank you.
pray, my brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. May this sacred offering, O Lord, confer on us always the blessing of salvation, that what it celebrates in mystery, it may accomplish in power, through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For in you we live and move and have our being, and while in this body we not only experience the daily effects of your care, but even now possess the pledge of life eternal. For having received the first fruits of the Spirit, through whom you raised up Jesus from the dead, we hope for an everlasting share in the Paschal mystery. And so with all the angels we praise you, as in joyful celebration we acclaim. Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy, and you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, so that they may become for us the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you will to reconcile us to yourself. Grant that we who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son and filled with his Holy Spirit may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, and with all the saints on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant Francis, our Pope, and Paul, our Bishop, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family whom you have summoned here before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who are pleasing to you with their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There, we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory, through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him and with him and in him, O God, almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
May the peace of the Lord be with you always. Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter into my room. Only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. Thank you.
Let us pray. Renewed by this bread from the heavenly table, we beseech you, Lord, that being the food of charity, it may confirm our hearts and stir us to serve you in our neighbor, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Two more weeks to go until our joint parish family picnic on September 15th after the 10:30 a.m. Mass. The Knights of Columbus will once again grill some hot dogs and hamburgers for us. Everyone is encouraged to bring and share your favorite salad or dessert. There will be a soccer game challenge with Father Kumu. Sign up to play soccer is in the narthex. Faith formation and youth programs registration is still under construction and will open up soon. Information day is next Sunday, September 8th, after the 10:30 a.m. Mass in the Ringley Room. If you have any questions or would like to know more about our programs, please plan to attend. The parish office is closed on Monday, September 2nd, in observance of the Labor Day holiday.
I am delighted that the parish picnic is actually going to be something that both of our communities will be part of, hosted here at St. Thomas More on the 15th. That was something that emerged in one of our joint staff meetings. And when people from St. Thomas More and the staff from Holy Rosary almost simultaneously said, why don't we just do it here all together? I think it's wonderful, great opportunity to further our opportunities to get to know each other. Speaking of which, this past Tuesday was the first day of our parish school, and so I was able to spend time on Tuesday and Wednesday here getting to better know our faculty and staff, and also getting to become now acquainted with our students and families. And so it's a wonderful occasion. And part of the great spirit of and energy of our school is our new principal, Mr. Rich Hernandez. And I had wanted Rich to be here tonight so you could see him for yourself. He's just an extraordinary young educator. But here's the thing. The Hernandezes made a decision to allow their youngest child, their son, to be able to finish high school where they've been. So that means that for this first year that Mr. Hernandez is with us, his wife and son are going to continue living in Lebanon, Oregon, just outside of Salem, and he will be getting a place and commuting back and forth. Now, that really speaks to my heart because my father did that once, and that's a hardship for a family, but what dedication to serve our community that Rich has. And anyway, he knew that I wanted him to be able to be with us this weekend, but then as we were finishing things at the end of the week, I said, well, now, wait a minute. This is a four-day weekend, isn't it? And you were going to be here for the whole 4 days? And I said, no, this is not right. You go be with your family, and then you can come and meet us the next time. So I hope it's okay with you. I think it's a good thing to do, don't you? Yeah, and you'll like him when you meet him. Okay, great. The Lord be with you. May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Let us go and explain the gospel one hour long.
Thanks be to God.
The closing hymn is for the hymn of the 212.
Thank you.
Lady Brule, do you know anything?
No.
I don't read the books. You read the books. Vivina, Vivina. How are you, Vivina?
Thank you.